And then the second word by
one.
Hour and moment by moment.
We want to begin with a special prayer request, and some of you are aware of this, and some of you are not. But the Kidders were involved in a car accident just a few moments ago on the way to church. So Ebby and Shirley, and so their car is very damaged. It seems like they are okay, that they're not injured, so that is good. But let's take a moment and pray for them. Father, Lord, we pray right now for Ebby and for Shirley. And Lord, we just pray that they have not been physically harmed. And so Lord, I just pray for their nerves and for them emotionally. Lord, for the other person or persons involved in the other car, Lord, we pray for them. And Lord, you know all about the situation. So we hand it into your hands, into your care. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. We'll ask you to stand, please, as we begin our time of worship.
Thank you.
Let's take a moment to pray together. Father God, we thank you for this beautiful day that you've given to us. God, we thank you for the beautiful people that you have gathered to this place to worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, we thank you for an opportunity to be able to come and to worship you and to focus upon you and only you. So, Lord, we pray that you would remove any distractions that are in our minds right now, that anything that would be percolating in our hearts and our souls, that, Lord, we would turn that over to you, that we would go and focus upon the Lord Jesus fully and completely, Lord, in these moments, in this hour that's before us. Lord, we pray for the children and for those that will be leading them and directing them this morning. Lord, we just pray that you would bless them, and Lord, just honor the leaders for their time commitment and their willingness to serve the little ones today. We pray for their parents and for their families today as well, and Lord, bless them, and Lord, encourage them and strengthen them as they lead the little ones towards you. We ask all this in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Let's see. Is Caleb here? I don't see Caleb. Okay, let's see. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to dismiss the children. So, yes, I need to do that. So you can go on your way. I don't see him. Sure.
Greta.
Good morning, everyone. The missions team has been working with our missionaries so that we could bring more and more information to you guys so that you know the awesome work that God is doing through them. This morning, we are going to watch a short video from Lucas and Becca Greta. I always say their name wrong, so thank you, Pastor Scott. So watch the screen, and then afterwards, we'll pray for them.
Hi, we're the Gretas. My name's Lucas. We are in Dakar, Senegal, teaching at Dakar Academy. I'm the athletic director and PE teacher here at Dakar Academy.
And I'm Becca, and I stay home with our three kids. Olivia is 5, and she'll start kindergarten in the fall. Caleb's 4, and Micah is 1. And I serve just through coaching and youth group and different events.
We've been in Senegal for about 3 years now, and at Dakar Academy. Dakar Academy is a mission school for missionaries, but also for people from the community to come as well. The purpose of the school is to provide an education for the children of missionaries so that they can focus on their ministry full-time while knowing that their kids are getting a good Christian education. So they know that is taken care of and that's kind of off their plate and they can focus more fully on their ministry. Dakar Academy is a very diverse place. There's over, I think, 40 countries represented here at Dakar Academy, kindergarten through 12th grade. And it's just a great opportunity to be able to serve and allow missionaries to do their ministry, but also impact kids' lives through interacting with them.
One of the things that we enjoy most is just through coaching and sports, because it's just outside of the classroom and just gives us a different perspective with the kids and a different kind of relation with the kids than in the classroom. We've also had the unique opportunity this year to have girls over to our house for dinner before youth group on Thursdays, and just really living God's light out to the kids here, doing life with them and having the opportunity to show them who Jesus is.
Thank you.
So we just want to give you a little bit of a snapshot about what we do here in Senegal and why we do it. We're very excited to be partnering with you, doing God's work in Senegal, and we look forward to what God has in store, and hopefully you guys are excited about that too. Thank you.
If many of you know this, but UBC has been partnering with this family for many generations. We partnered with their parents and with their grandparents. So this is wonderful to see the generation continue. So would you guys join me for a moment as we pray for them? Heavenly Father, what a wonderful opportunity that you have blessed us with to partner with such wonderful missionaries who have dedicated their lives to spreading your gospel. Gosh, Lord, these guys get to live life with all of these children. They get to show them what it is like to live a life with Jesus guiding every step of their path. Lord, we pray that you will work in their family, keep their health well. I know that they have been struggling with some things, issues with their kids. They've been getting sick a lot. So, Lord, we pray that as a great physician that you will keep them all healthy and energized and able to keep up with all these kids that they work with. Lord, I pray that that you will continue to send the Holy Spirit out and touch the hearts of everyone that they are going to come into contact with. Prepare their hearts for your gospel, and Lord, just bless them as they commit themselves to you and their families. And thank you, Lord, that we get to partner with them. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Thank you, Jerrianna. The global mission team, our global mission team is doing a great job. We had a meeting this past Tuesday night, and many of them on the team are young and doing this for the first time, but it's exciting what they're doing, and you'll be hearing a lot about more about our missionaries over the next couple of weeks and throughout the summer, so we're looking forward to that. We are going to have communion at the end of our service today, so I failed to mention that at the very beginning. So for those watching online, if you would like to go and take part, get something that you can use for the bread and for the cup, and for those in this room, if you have not picked up, it looks like you have because the table is empty, so we will use that at the end of the service as we have communion today. Well, my Bible is open this morning to John chapter 12. So if you have your Bible, or if you'd like to use one of the Bibles that's in the seat in front of you, underneath the seat, you can feel free to do that, or use your tablet or phone. And John chapter 12, verse 23. John 12, 23 is where we're going to be this morning. Now, last week we were in John chapter 10, and a lot has happened from where we left off last week in the life of Jesus to where we come to this week. Now, a very short period of time has gone by, but two amazing events has happened. In John chapter 11, Jesus has raised Lazarus from the dead. That's a pretty amazing event. So Jesus has raised Lazarus, who had been dead for 4 days in the tomb. And he said, Lazarus, come forth, and he came out and fully alive. That's an amazing event. And then in the first part of John chapter 12, Jesus arrives in the city of Jerusalem to this huge crowd, John tells us, a huge crowd. And we don't know what that huge crowd, what number that was. It could have been hundreds, it could have been thousands, and most scholars say it was probably around 10,000 people. 10,000 people welcome Jesus to the city of Jerusalem as he comes there for Passover with his 12 disciples. And this is more familiar to us as Palm Sunday. Remember Palm Sunday? And the whole crowd, they shout out, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And they just shout that out over and over and over and over. Can you imagine being welcomed by 10,000 people that are just screaming out and crying out and welcoming you to a place? That would be pretty amazing, wouldn't it be? I was trying to think back, and you know, have I ever experienced anything close to that, and a fraction of that. But this was many years ago in my previous church, and it was a Sunday night. And on this Sunday night, next door, I was in the parsonage, and next door was the church building. And over in the church building, they were having a special business meeting that night to decide whether or not I was going to be their next senior pastor. So I'm in the house, basically, to be honest with you, kind of pacing back and forth. And I'm expecting the meeting probably to go for 30 to 45 minutes. And after about 15 minutes, the doorbell rings. And I go to the door, and it's the chairman of the pulpit committee, and he says, "Congratulations, you're our new pastor." And I will pray about it, and I'll respond to you maybe tomorrow. And he's like, "Oh, no. He says, "Here's the vote. It was almost unanimous, and you're our new pastor, and, you know, is your answer yes?" And he says, "And everybody's still over the church, and they're waiting for you over there." So I said, "Well, okay, what were the numbers again? What was the percentage?" I said, "Okay, my answer is yes." And so we went across the lawn. We came through doors like this into a room very much like this. And instantaneously, about 100 people jumped to their feet, standing ovation, and just tremendous applause that seemed like it went on forever and ever. Probably went on for like 5 or 6 minutes. And I'm like, all this was happening so fast, and I wasn't expecting that. I was like, wow. It's like, this probably will never happen again. This is a once-in-a-lifetime thing. I'm just kind of like taking it all in. It truly was like a thrill of the lifetime. And just the love and the support and all of that. And then they're like, "Okay, you have to give a speech. Okay, come up. You gotta say something." So I was like, "Okay, you know, thank you. I mean, I don't know what to say." I mean, I was just like shocked. And everyone's still like standing. They're still like clapping. And I'm like, "Okay, stop and sit down." And you know, and it's like it's a great honor and things like that. Well, this is where we are with Jesus in John 12:23. And thousands of people have welcomed him to the city, and basically they're now saying, there's some Gentiles that came up to him, and it's like, "We would like a private audience." And Jesus is like, "No, I've come to the nation of Israel." He doesn't tell us that in John, but in other places. But Jesus, in verse 23, basically gives his speech. So let's read what Jesus says in verse 23, John chapter 12. Jesus replied, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified." The hour has come for the Son of Man, referring to himself, to be glorified. The time has come. The time that I've been talking about is now. Now is the time for the Son of Man to be glorified, right now. And for his 12 disciples, and for this massive crowd, they would have been like, "Yes! Finally, the time that we've been waiting for, that the Son of Man, the King, this great King that we've been expecting for hundreds of years," because what would have been in their minds, their thinking at this point, is Daniel chapter 7 that we looked at several months ago. But let's put that on the screen. It says, Daniel wrote this, "In my vision at night I looked, and there before me was one like a Son of Man, coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence." Verse 14, "He was given authority, glory, sovereign power. All nations and peoples of every language worshiped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed." And so that they're understanding, this is what Jesus is talking about. He says, "I am the Son of Man, and I am here to be glorified in this very hour, in this very time." And so they were like, "Yes, you're going to restore the kingdom of Israel. You're going to destroy the Romans that have come and taken over our land. Everything that we've ever dreamed about is going to happen right now." But let's come to verse 24. Because we're going through this series, aren't we, that's called Double Amen. And we've seen now many times that Jesus will go and say, "Amen, amen," which means truth, truth. So again, Jesus, in a sense, he raises his right hand as if he is on the witness stand. And he says, "Okay, what I'm about to say to you is the truth, nothing but the truth, so help me God. And what I'm about to say to you is very important, and listen very closely to what I'm about to say. And what does Jesus say? He says something that they were not expecting. He says, "Very truly, I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds, much fruit." Jesus here gives a very simple farmer's principle, right? That I learned in kindergarten. In kindergarten, my teacher gave us little cups and filled them with dirt and gave us a little seed for a marigold plant, I think it was, and you plant that, and they're like, okay, we water that, and then we keep coming back every day and we look to see what happens. Now, what happened? From a very scientific point of view, we put that seed in there, any type of seed. Here's a kernel of wheat. You put it into the ground, and that seed dies. It rots. But out of that seed comes new life. And out of that new life comes some kind of plant, a marigold plant, or in this case, wheat. And they would have been very familiar with that. And out of that wheat will come seeds, a multitude of seeds, and all kinds of new life. And so that is what Jesus, he says, this is how I'm going to be glorified. Not that I'm now going to become king as you expect. I'm going to die. And from my death will come this great multitude of new life. Now think about it. Because Jesus' death, there have been tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions, tens of millions, hundreds of millions of people, including us, that now experience eternal life because of the death of one person, the Lord Jesus Christ. So he says, this is truth. This is very, very, very important. So my first point this morning is this. Jesus predicted his death. Jesus predicts his death. And out of his death will come this multiplication of life. But think of it from the disciples. They would have been like, no, 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 no. We have come too far to talk anything about death. Why do you keep this crazy talk? You keep bringing this up. You're going to die. You're going to die. No. And think of it especially from the perspective of Judas, one of the 12. And he was the leading one that was like, okay, Jesus, you need to be king now. You need to be king now. You need to be king now. Because Judas, he had wrong motives, didn't he? We know that. We'll find that out in the coming days by the end of this week that we're looking at this morning, that he was all in it for all the money. But from Judas's perspective, it's like, no, you cannot die. No, 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 no. That's not part of the plan. And look at the crowds, Jesus. Look, 10,000 people have shown up. Yes, your approval ratings were way down. Yes, I admit that over the last couple of years or the last year, the last few months. But when you raise Lazarus from the dead, oh, you've grabbed everybody's attention. And Jesus, all you need to do is raise a few more dead people. If you would do that, 100,000 people would be celebrating you. And maybe all the nations of the world would come because they're going to celebrate somebody who can raise people from the dead. So just raise a few more people. And would Judas be right? Absolutely. If Jesus every day is like, well, I'll just raise one more person from the dead, would that grab people's attention? Would he have been glorified? Would he have been given great honor and approval? I mean, his approval ratings would be off the charts. But Jesus is like, that's not how it's going to work. No, that's not how it's going to work. But think about it. Jesus is tempted. He would have been very tempted to go, it's like, wow. Because when you have a standing ovation and you have tremendous applause and great approval ratings, that's a great temptation to go and say, yeah, I think I'll go and do it this way. But Jesus is like, no. So Jesus, instead, he predicts his death.
Verse 25. In verse 25, he says, anyone who loves his life will lose it, while anyone who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. What is Jesus talking about here? Let me share with you the SAB translation, how I would translate this verse. It says, if you live thinking about your life is all about you, making yourself a big deal now, you will experience eternal loss, eternal death, eternal separation from God later. He said, if that's your focus now, it's all about me now. He says, in the end, you're going to miss everything that God is doing, and you're going to end up being eternally separated from God that we've talked about in recent weeks. And so the second point is this, and it leads into a major kingdom principle. So if you're taking notes, you might want to fill in these words. Serve now. Serve now and be honored later. Serve now and be honored later. Now, the worldly principle, as I wrote to you this week, is just the opposite. Is just the opposite of this, because the principles of the worldly kingdoms is always the opposite of the kingdom principle. And even in my own heart, and I would guess in your heart as well, is like, well, it's just the opposite. It would be great if I could get some approval, some honor and respect now. And maybe it would be really nice, maybe not like what Scott experienced, but it'd be really nice, maybe just for like 30 seconds, just for one time, to walk through the doors of any particular room and to have a standing ovation and everyone having this tremendous applause just because I'm entering the room. If even for 30 seconds, it's like, oh, that would be really nice. And then someday when I go to heaven, yeah, then I'm willing to serve God forever and ever. And we kind of think deep down inside that's how life should be. But Jesus said, no, the other way around. Serve now, suffer now, sacrifice now, deny yourself now, and be honored later. And we say, no, it just seems like it should be the other way around. But Jesus said, no, that's what he's saying here. This is the way it is. You have to die to self. In verse 26, he says, anyone who serves me, must follow my example. Where I am, my servant will also be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. See, there's honor coming, but it's not now. It's later. We will be honored. We will receive the applause. We will receive all of the approval by God the Father later, not in this world, but in the world to come. And that's what Jesus says here. And so that's the kingdom principle. Serve now and be honored later. Life is about serving and following Jesus now. Serving Jesus is wanting God the Father's applause more than the applause of the crowd. Because if we follow this principle, we're not going to get the applause of the crowd now. We're not. And we may even be looked down upon. We may be even considered very strange compared to other people. Because it's like, okay, you're just serving, you're just having this humble spirit, you're even sacrificing things and how you use your money and things like that. And yeah, people are just gonna, you're not gonna get any applause. But Jesus says here, the truth is, someday if you serve my Father now, you serve me now, you will be honored later. So God the Father's plan is for you to serve him now, and that will involve suffering and sacrifice and pain and difficulty. In some cases, a God-honoring life is not lived focused on you. A God-honoring life is lived focused on how one day you will stand before God the Father and he will give you all of the honor and the glory, that we will be honored in a very special way for all of eternity. So here's the takeaway this morning. Serving Jesus now means you will be honored by God the Father later. Jesus, that's the truth. Serving Jesus now means you will be honored by God the Father later. Not now, but later. Point number three, Jesus made the right choice. Verse 27. Jesus made the right choice. He says, "Now my soul is troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour?" No, it was for this very reason, this very purpose, I came to this hour, came to this world. Father, glorify your name. The word troubled, "Now my soul is troubled," can be translated horrified. The English word horrified. My soul is horrified as I think about what is about to happen to me in this hour. Because Jesus could look ahead to the end of that week. We're now on a Sunday, Palm Sunday, remember where we are, and look ahead to what's going to happen that week. What was going to happen to Jesus? The crowds would dissipate very quickly. All of that applause, all of that approval rating would just go away. One of his closest and dearest friends, Judas, would betray him. Peter would deny him. All the 12 disciples would disappear, run away. Jesus would be arrested, falsely accused. He would be put on trial in the middle of the night, on a lawful trial. He would be beaten, tortured, and nailed to a tree. He says, "My soul is horrified, troubled when I think about all that is going through." But he says, should I go and say, "No, I'm going to change the plan"? Jesus said, "For this reason is why I have come to the world." Jesus knew that the reason that he was born some 30 years earlier was for that very hour, for that very time, to come and to be God the Father's sacrifice for the sins of the entire world. Jesus knew why he was here, and he makes that choice. It was a horrifying thought for Jesus, who knew no sin, to become sin on our behalf. It was a horrifying thought when, for the first time, the unbroken relationship between God the Father and God the Son would be broken as the Father, God the Father, turned his back for those 6 hours that Jesus hung on the cross, because Jesus had become all of our sin, and that eternal relationship was broken. How horrifying a thought. It was a horrifying thought for Jesus to take all of God's wrath for our sin upon himself. In those 6 hours on the cross, from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m., the whole wrath of God, all of the wrath that was intended for us, was all placed upon Jesus, and he took it all. That eternal death that we've been talking about in recent weeks, all was placed upon him, that eternal separation from God. Jesus experienced all of that for us. Jesus could see the horror of the future, but at the moment, he was the hero of the crowd. There were still thousands of people that were cheering him on, and he had that choice, and I think he did, because he was 100%, he is 100% man, 100% God. In his humanness, it's like, I think we'll just, God will just go with this plan. This might work better. But see, he knew the truth, though. It was only through his death and through the cross that we would experience life, eternal life. So he knew he had to go through with the plan. So Jesus needed to choose whose applause he wanted, just as we do, just as I do, just as you do. And in verse 28, as we read, Father, glorify your name. Now, note here, he does not say, Father, glorify my name. He doesn't say that. Even though in verse 23, he says, it's time, the hour for me to be glorified. But he knew that he would eventually be glorified through his glorification, the Father's glorification by his death on the cross. And then a voice in verse 29, it says, then a voice came from heaven, and there was an audible voice, which is very rare, even in Bible days, that there was this audible voice from heaven. God the Father speaks, and he says, it has been glorified, and it will be glorified again. And people are like, wait a minute, was that thunder? Was that a voice from an angel speaking to Jesus? What was that? They knew something had happened, but they didn't know what it was. And then Jesus said, it was not for my benefit, it was for your benefit. He says, now is the time for judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world, the devil, will be driven out. And when I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all people to myself. He said this to show the kind of death he was going to die. Now is the time of judgment on this world. He says, we'll draw all people to myself. He said, this will show what kind of death he was going to die. So how would this happen? How would God the Father be glorified through the life of Jesus? How would the Son accomplish his work, his mission? How would Satan be defeated? How would sin be conquered? How would death be overcome? Jesus would be lifted up upon the cross. The cross. When Jesus was lifted up on the cross, it drew all people to himself. The cross, which was so horrifying for Christ to go through, would be the way in which he would conquer as the king of the world. The cross was where sin would be overcome. The cross was where Satan would be defeated. The cross was where Jesus would glorify his Father. When Christ and the cross were lifted up, God drew all people to himself. Let's put on the screen reality. It's all about Jesus in the cross. It's all about Jesus in the cross. Without Jesus, we have no salvation. Without the cross, we have no salvation. Without Jesus, without the cross, we do not have eternal life. We do not have that personal, loving relationship with God that we can experience through Christ and his death on the cross. The means was his death on the cross. And when we lift up Jesus and we lift up the cross, even as we're doing this morning in this room, God will draw all people to himself. Jesus will be glorified, and he will be praised. When Jesus returned to heaven 40 days after being raised from the dead, we're told in Philippians chapter 2 that God the Father exalted him to the highest position, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Jesus will be glorified. Is glorified. God the Father is glorified. It all happens because of Jesus' willingness to die on the cross. To honor the Father and to save us, Jesus chose, he made that choice, the most horrifying death that the world, mankind, has ever conceived. He knew no sin. He took on our sin. He endured the full wrath of God the Father. He experienced that unbroken communion between God the Father for the first and only time so that we might have eternal life. Jesus had to make a choice. Whose applause would he live for? The crowds? 100,000 people cheering him on in this world? Or the applause of one, God the Father? Jesus chose to live for the applause of one person, his Father in heaven. My fourth point this morning, an audience of one. What does that mean? An audience of one. Our desire, my desire, is to receive the approval from one person, and that's God the Father. Like Jesus, you'll need to choose where you'll receive the applause. Either get it now in this world, as our tendency wants to be in our humanness and our sinfulness. It's like, I want all the applause now, all the approval now, give it to me now. Or to go and to follow in the footsteps of Jesus and say, well, no, I'm the servant now. Because what did Philippians 2 say? That Jesus humbled himself. He came in the likeness of a man. He further humbled himself unto death, even death upon a cross. He was the servant of God. And so we must be that servant as well. To get that applause, it means life will be difficult. Just as Jesus denied himself, we, you, I will need to deny ourselves. So I have a question. Whose applause are you living for? The applause, the recognition, the approval of the people around you today, your friends, your family, your coworkers. That's like, oh yeah, they're like, you're a great person, you're a wonderful person. Or the applause of the one God, the Father. Verse 26 gives us the clue, I think, when Jesus said, whoever serves me must follow me. You must follow in my footsteps, is literally how it could be translated. You must follow in my footsteps. And so that's what we do. Following Jesus means turning away from the applause of the crowd and living for the applause of the one. All that matters on that future day is God the Father, when we stand before him, giving us his applause. Now, is it literally going to be applause? No, I don't think so. What does the Bible say? There's going to be words spoken. And what words will be spoken on that day? Tremendous words. Words that we should all of us, every single one of us, who are followers of Christ should live for. When God the Father will say, well done, my good and faithful, what? Servant. Well done, my faithful servant. See, we are servants now. Includes suffering, sacrifice, denial, pain, suffering, difficulties, as Jesus went through. Not that necessarily we have to give up our own life, but maybe in a sense we give up being number one, we give up all of our priorities, makes Jesus our priority for the applause of one, God the Father. That's what I'm living for. I hope that's what you're living for as well. I'm going to ask the worship team to come up, and they're going to lead us in a very familiar song, a song that talks about surrender. And then we'll come to the communion table.
Thank you.
seated. How did Jesus ever go through the difficult experiences that we've described a few moments ago? How did he do that? He said, "My soul is troubled, it is horrified of what I'm about to go through." How did he ever do it? The Bible tells us that it was for the joy set before him he endured the cross. What a fascinating statement. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross. What joy? Well, the joy that one day he would be exalted to the highest place? Well, maybe. But that's not how a servant thinks. The joy that was set before him was, he knew, as he said in verse 23, that if I lay down my life, that there would be this great multitude of people, us, that would be able to experience eternal life, a personal, loving relationship with Almighty God for all of eternity. I think that's the joy. He was able to look ahead to that week. But Jesus also had the ability to look ahead much further, even to this hour, to this day. Tens of millions of people that have come into the kingdom that declares that he is their king. So he was willing to go and to do the great sacrifice of dying upon the cross. But he was also willing. He was willing, he was able, he was without sin. He could not have accomplished this if he was a sinner like us. He was 100% without sin. Otherwise, he would have to die for his own sins upon the cross. But because of his sinlessness, he was able to die for our sins, to be our substitute, to take our place. And so they nailed him to a tree, literally, to a cross that he dragged through the city of Jerusalem to the place of Golgotha, the place of the cross, the place of the skull, and they nailed him there, and the wrath of God came upon him, and all of our sins came upon him, and the punishment for the whole world was on him. And so we go and we take this little wafer that's on the top there, and I break it. As Jesus said in the upper room 2,000 years ago, he said, "This is my body. This represents my body, which is broken for you." He says, "Give thanks." And let's give thanks and remember this. So let's give thanks. Lord Jesus, we thank you today with grateful hearts that you were willing to have your own body broken, the nails, the spikes driven into your hands, your wrists, into your feet, your ankles, the spear to be thrust into your side, your body broken. And as we sang earlier in the service, that these scars are still yet visible today as a constant eternal reminder of your sacrifice being our substitute. So God, we simply today, we give you thanks. Thank you, thank you. Thank you. We're a grateful people. And Lord, bless this bread to our bodies as we remember the body of Christ broken for us. Let's eat it together. The Bible also tells us that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. We talked about that last month at communion. But it was by the blood of Christ that doesn't just hide our sins, as in the Old Testament days. The blood doesn't just cover our sins. The blood removes our sin, never to be remembered by God ever again. As far as the east is from the west, our sins are forgotten. never to be recalled. So let's drink of the cup together. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the blood of Christ. Precious is that flow that takes away our sins and that you remember them no more. Oh, Father, thank you, thank you, thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, for the person of Christ, and for the work of Christ upon the cross. God, we acknowledge today it's all about Jesus and it's all about the cross. Without Jesus and without the cross, we would still be lost in our sins. We would have no relationship with you. We would be damned to experience all of the wrath of God forever. But Lord, it is all so different now because we have the Lord Jesus Christ. God, I pray for anyone in this room or anyone that's listening to my voice today, if they have not come to Christ and begged for forgiveness and repented to say, I want to live a new life, to go in a direction towards you, to entrust their lives to you as the Savior of the world, to be their substitute. God, I pray that they would do it at this very moment in time. For today is the day of salvation. Today is still an opportunity to cry out to God, save me, rescue me, make me a new person. And God, we know that whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, will be rescued. That's a promise, that eternal promise. We claim that promise today. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. As we close the service today, just a couple of quick announcements. A week from Tuesday on Tuesday, June 21st at 6 p.m. out here in the parking lot, we are going to have a cookout. We're going to cook some hot dogs. We're going to have some rolls. And we would ask you to bring something to share. It could be a salad. It could be chips. It could be dessert, whatever. And one of our missionary couples, Ken and Lucy Davis, who serve in Brazil, we've supported them for many years. They're going to be here in Maine. They're going to be in Old Town. They cannot be here on a Sunday. They can't be here on a Wednesday. That would be typical. But they called this week and said, could we come on a Tuesday evening? I said, yes. And so we're going to have a cookout. They are going to share with their ministry what they do as missionaries down in Brazil for a little bit. And are we still looking for housing? Has anyone? Okay, so a week from Tuesday night, we're looking for someone to house overnight, Ken and Lucy. They did share with me this week that 3 weeks ago they had COVID. So they think that's kind of behind them. They've been vaccinated. So if you're concerned about that, inviting them into your home. So just overnight, serve them breakfast. They'll be on their way early in the morning to go off to their next church location somewhere here in Maine. And so if you could speak to me after the service or Jerry Anna, and that will be an important thing. Okay, so we're going to say farewell to those that are watching on Facebook Live. Thank you for joining us this morning. And may you have a wonderful week, and hopefully you can join us soon here in this room, in this building. And may the Lord bless you.